I prepared for you a guest speaker today. I know Rick was here last week and did a good job and wonderful job. And today, so Pastor, would you come up? Sikkim girl. Yeah.
Come on, guys. Wake up.
Oh, yeah. I keep hearing people say, I need a getaway. We got that getaway that takes them to a whole new place. Won't leave us empty.
Praise the Lord. Well, I want to say thank you too to heard last week and came up and had hands laid on me and prayed for me, and the love that has just been poured out has been really such a blessing. I cannot thank you enough. And I had a wonderful week, absolutely wonderful week. And I'm believing that whatever that crazy thing was, it is gone in the name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. All righty. So I have kind of a serious message this morning, but I am going to quit at 12 o'clock. Okay? So y'all can watch that clock if you want. I got mine right here. Yeah. I'm gonna stop at 12 o'clock, so I might not get done. But we've got youngsters in this morning, and I don't want to wear out anybody. So anyway, Let's just open in prayer, shall we? Father, I just give you thanks for the privilege of standing here, Lord God. You have put a word in my heart, and it's just been burning, Lord. And so what a privilege it is that I could stand before these that I love so much and just be able to share what I believe you're speaking to me, and I think to the body of Christ, Lord God. And so, Father, I just pray, as Paul did in Ephesians, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, make us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened, and that we would know, we would of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead, and he seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. Amen? And so I just pray that, Lord God, that you would, by your Spirit, help me to communicate the things that you have laid on my heart. Thank you, Father. And so I entitled my sermon, God's People. I really did this like a real pastor, you guys. I have a title to my sermon, and I have 3 points I want to make. And I might not get it done, like I said, but we'll get a start on it. And the first point I want to make is division. Division in the world, division in the body of Christ, which is so prevalent right now. And it is a sign of the times. We know that we're in the last days. We don't know what that means as far as the timing. But when Jesus returned to the Father, that began the last days, the latter days. And so we're 2,000 years further into it than we were then. The second point I want to make is, what is it to be God's people or kingdom citizens? And finally, how Jesus dealt with division in his day. And so I want to take you to Luke 21, if you want to turn there, please. And we'll start at verse 6. I'm going to read quite a little bit because I want to put this in context. I thought about just pulling out the key verses that I was wanting to emphasize, but I thought, you know what? When we read the word, we need to read it in context. So let's read a little bit further. So again, Luke 21, and starting at verse 7. I like the Amplified version, and so that's what is up on the screen, if it's easier for you to read along that way. And they asked him, "Teacher, when will this happen? And what sign will there be when this is about to occur?" And he said, "Be on your guard and be careful that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name, appropriating to themselves the name Messiah, which belongs to me, saying, 'I am he.' And the time is at hand. Do not go out after them. And when you hear of wars and insurrections, disturbances, disorder, and confusion, do not become alarmed and panic-stricken and terrified, for all this must take place first, but the end will not come immediately." Then he told them, "Nation will rise up against nation, and kingdom against kingdom." And that word nation in the Greek is ethos, which means ethnicity. It actually means race against race. Is any of this sounding familiar? They dealt with it then, and it's the same spirit that wreaked havoc then that is wreaking havoc now. So he said, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be mighty and violent earthquakes, and in various places famines and pestilence, plagues, malignant and contagious or infectious epidemic diseases, which are deadly and devastating. And there will be sights of terror and great signs from heaven. But previous to all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, turning you over to the synagogues and prisons, and you will be led away before kings and governors for my sake, for my name's sake. This will be a time, an opportunity for you to bear testimony. I think that is really awesome. And that's exactly what happened to them in that day, is they suffered greatly. They were persecuted. They were put to death. They had to hide, to gather together. But Jesus said, this is going to be a time of testimony. I think this is a time of testimony for us. Resolve and settle it in your minds not to meditate, and prepare beforehand how you are to make your defense and how you will answer. For I myself will give you a mouth and such utterance and wisdom that all of your foes combined will be unable to stand against or refute. You will be delivered up and betrayed even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and some of you they will put to death. And I just hate to say the divisions that are happening amongst many families right now. And you will be hated, despised by everyone because you bear my name and for its sake. But not a hair on your head shall perish. By your steadfastness and patient endurance, you shall win the true life of your souls. Steadfast and patient endurance. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know and understand that its desolation has come near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let those who are inside the city get out of it, and let not those who are out in the country come into it. For those are days of vengeance, of rendering full justice or satisfaction, that all things that are written may be fulfilled. All things that are written are being fulfilled today. Alas, for those who are pregnant and for those who have babies which they are nursing in those days, for great misery and angst and distress shall be upon the land, and indignation and punishment and retribution upon this people. They will fall by the mouth and the edge of the sword, and will be led away as captives to and among all nations. And Jerusalem will be trodden down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled, they're completed. And there will be signs in the sun and moon and stars, and upon the earth there will be distress, trouble, and anguish of nations, and bewilderment and perplexity, without resources, left wanting, embarrassed, in doubt, not knowing which way to turn, at the roaring, the echo, the echo of the tossing of the sea. It kind of reminds me of what's going on right now, too. Men swooning away or expiring with fear and dread and apprehension and expectation of the things that are coming on the world, for the very powers of the heavens will be shaken and caused to totter. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with great transcendent and overwhelming power and all his kingly glory, majesty, and splendor. Now, when these things begin to occur, look up and lift up your heads, because your redemption, your deliverance, is drawing near. I believe that's a word for us today. When these things are happening, look up. And he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they put forth their buds and come out and leaf, you see for yourselves and perceive and know that summer is already near. Even so, when you see these things taking place, understand and know that the kingdom of God is at hand. Truly, I tell you, this generation who's living at the definite period of time will not perish and pass away until all has taken place. The sky and the earth, that is the universe, the world, will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But take heed to yourselves and be on your guard, lest your hearts be overburdened and depressed, weighed down with the giddiness and headache and nausea of self-indulgence, drunkenness, and worldly worries and cares, pertaining to the business of this life, unless that day come upon you suddenly like a trap or a noose. For it will come upon all who live upon the face of the entire earth. Keep awake. Keep awake then, and watch at all times. Be discreet, attentive, and ready, praying that you may have the full strength and ability and be accounted worthy to escape all these things taken together that will take place and to stand in the presence of the Son of Man. Pretty sobering word. Pretty sobering word. And we can read that and say, well, that was for then. But the same spirit that was operating then is operating today. And he's got nothing new under the sun. And Jesus gave us his word for instruction to prepare us. And so that's my aim right now in reading these scriptures. Let's read one more and then we'll go on. Matthew 24, and we'll start at verse 10. This also speaks. This was the same time. Now Matthew's reporting, and this is what he had to say. He said, "And then many will be offended and repelled and will begin to distrust and desert him whom they ought to trust and obey, and will stumble and fall away and betray one another and pursue one another with hatred. And many false prophets will rise up and deceive and lead many into error. And the love of the great body of people will grow cold because of multiplied lawlessness and iniquity. But he who endures to the end will be saved. And this good news of the kingdom, the gospel, will be preached throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come." And then the end will come. So if we want Jesus to come back, we need to be busy preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Amen? So I've been observing the spirit of division in the world and in the church, and this really has been concerning me. I have to be honest with you, almost all the conversations I'm hearing lately, in or outside of the church, are about the COVID pandemic and the statistics concerning it, the issue of Black Lives Matter, politics and the upcoming election. Those are the main conversations that I'm hearing right now. Even amongst Christians, there's disagreement when these subjects come up, and I've even seen and witnessed some pretty heated discussions. I see God's people offending and being offended, some even leaving the church. Y'all might not be aware of that, but there's some missing, and that's why. Not everybody believes the same things that we believe. We might think they do, but some have been very offended. So what's going on? What do you think? What is the truth? Who can we believe? Many people don't know what to believe. I'm one of them. I hear so much stuff. There's a spirit of confusion in the air, and we kind of read about that in I can't remember if it was in Luke and Matthew, but they were confused. They were running fro. They didn't know what to do. People are confused. The facts don't bring clarity. There's so much information out there from different sources with different agendas that it's getting harder and harder to trust what you hear. Who's telling the truth? I keep saying if I could find a source that I can depend on to tell the truth. Just tell the facts. You don't have to give me your opinions. You don't have to color it. Just tell me, give me the facts. If I could find something like that, I'd be on board on staying up to date on that kind of stuff. And I do think that we need to not hide our heads in the sand. I believe that we do need to be informed. But unfortunately, the sources that can truly inform us with the right, truthful information, they're just few and far between. And I don't have time for that. I just don't have time for that. And so, honestly, I've spoken to many of you already that I associate a lot with. I tell you, I don't watch the news. I'm not on social media. I don't read the paper. I'm not on the internet because I don't have time for that. I really just don't have time for that. My husband stays informed, and he tells me what little I want to know. But honestly, I believe with all my heart that God will let me know what's going on. I really believe that. And so I believe that there's a great distraction going on. I believe that so much of this is intended to distract the people of God. Because I see it. I see the distraction. And I really believe that the devil is using this craziness to distract God's people. He knows his time is short, and he is working overtime, let me tell you. And I know y'all are feeling it. I told my teens, I said, I have a different point of reference than you do because I've been here for 66 years. These teens are like 14, 15, 16. And so I told them, I said, all this stuff going on may seem like, yeah, it's weird, but, you know, probably, you know, I mean, I said, no, it's really weird. It's really weird. I have never in 66 years seen it like this. I've seen some stuff. I grew up in the 60s, people. But this is like, woo. I mean, it just seems to be coming from every angle. It's incredible. And unfortunately, some people, they've got their TVs on all day long listening to the news. Some are spending great amounts of time on the internet searching for facts. Some still get their news from newspapers, believe it or not. Yeah. Some are listening to their friends or other experts on social media. He said, she said, did you hear this? You know, it's like, oh, gosh, give it a break. Though I believe that these are very serious issues, I'm not undermining that. I also see how Satan is using it to divide. So, my question to you all, at the sound of my voice, what are you feeding on? What's your mind occupied with? How much time are we spending in the book? This one right here. I know I can trust this. How much time are we spending in that? How much time are we spending quietly before the Lord, enjoying him and bringing him our prayers and petitions? He promised that he would hear us. So, why are we spending so much time on all this other stuff? What's it produce? Anxiety? Fear? How much time are we spending? I'm sorry, I don't get along with these things. How much time are we spending listening for truth and guidance? He said, nothing will happen on this earth that you won't be told ahead of time. But we got to be listening. And if our minds are preoccupied with all the other stuff, I'm sorry, but you aren't going to hear it. Most of you have heard me say, at least give God equal time. At least do that. If you're going to spend an hour watching news on TV, internet, whatever, talking about all the stuff that's going on, give God equal time. Spend an hour with him. Let's talk about him. Okay? What's the great things God's been doing for you lately? Let's have those conversations. Golly, it's 12 o'clock. Oh, my goodness. Next week, at this same place, at this same time, we're going to talk about what is it to be God's people, kingdom citizens. What does that mean? What's that look like? All right? So I didn't want to leave you on a bummer. It's really not a bummer at all. I just really believe that God is saying, wake up, my people. Wake up, my people, because you can make a difference. But as long as the enemy is distracting you with things that are not true, which I venture to say that a great majority of it is not true. I can't give you a percentage, but it's proven itself out that it's not true. Many of the things that we're hearing and seeing, the news media, they tilt it. They only show you certain things. The statistics that come out, it just depends on whose agenda, what they're trying to prove. And so God is saying, wake up, my people. Wake up. I really can prepare you, and you can walk in peace and victory. All right? So, Father, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for the body of Christ. I want to thank you for people who hunger and thirst after you, Lord God. I want to thank you for people who go out in a world that is looking for answers and has the answer, Lord. I want to thank you for that. I want to thank you, Lord God, that this is a great time to live. I want to thank you, Father, that this is a time for testimony. And people may not understand it. They may think you don't care because you can walk in peace. But Lord God, I thank you that you will be revealed through your people. And let us be those. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for spending time with us this morning. Thank you for being online with us this morning. God bless you, everyone. Give somebody some sugar before you get out of here. Amen.
Jesus, you don't owe me anything, more than anything that you can do. I just want you. And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't own me. Thank you.
Set our heart on you right now. Come person. I believe that there's power in the name. I believe that he died to free us. I believe that he rose from the grave. I believe he was born of a virgin. I believe he was a sacrificial lamb. I believe he ascended to the Father.
Y'all can be seated for a minute. Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. We want to welcome the people on the live stream also. Thanks for joining us. We're going to go ahead and open in prayer this morning. Dear Lord, thank you for this day, God. We pray a blessing over our service, Lord, over our worship. We invite you in to be with us this morning, Lord. Thank you for all of your blessings, God. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. All right. Everything's pretty much the same. We have the Wednesday evening Bible study still starting September 9th, led by Miss Denny Bettencourt. Very excited about that. Make sure you check it out. And then we have the junior church outing on September 12th, so it's next Saturday. So Miss Tammy is heading that up. Hi, Miss Tammy. if you could let her know if you're going to go. It'll be a great time going to the lake and having some fun with the kids. So let's do that. And then the women's conference is coming up. Yay. So it's the September 25th through the 27th, and it's going to be here. So we're very excited about that. If you're a visitor this morning, we want to welcome you guys. We have a gift for you if you'll see the desk out here at the end of service. Thank you for coming. And did I miss anything? Did I get it all today? Cool. Okay. I remember you, Paul. Ushers.
Okay, I'd like to offer a little blessing on the offering. Okay, thank you, dear Lord, for the opportunity to pay back a small amount of what you've given us monetarily. We also thank you for the many, many other things you give us. And today I'd like you to also offer a little extra blessing to the people who physically come here and keep our church and our grounds in special shape. They give more than just their money, and we appreciate that so much. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, let's stand and worship as they take the offering this morning.
Your love.
doing this morning, you guys? Are we happy to be here? I'm very, very happy and thankful to be here this morning. There's a lot of people that aren't able to do this right now, so I'm grateful.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Well, I'm pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not a man. Struck down but not destroyed. Beyond the curse, for his promise will endure. This joy is gonna be my strength. Though sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes in the morning. We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Joy of the Lord.
Say yes.
We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen.
Come on.
We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
One more time, say yes to him.
We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Give him some praise this morning, you guys. Come on. Okay, we can do better than that. Get loud for him for a second. Hallelujah. Come on. Thank you. Praise you, Jesus. Okay. This song is very old, but it's so good. We sang this when I was growing up, and it always gave me such peace, even as a really little girl. And it was on my heart this week, and so we decided to bring it to you guys this morning. I really want us to think about the words and just let it be an encouragement this morning. Just worship.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got of mind like you've never known. Then things change and you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you are never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make it right.
the good times, He's still God in the bad times, the God of the day is still God in the night. You talk of faith, you're up on the mountain, the talk comes easy. But down in the valley of trials and temptations, that's when faith is really put to the test. But the God on the mountain is still God in the valleys. When things go God in the night, but the God on the mountains is still God in the valleys. When things go wrong, He'll make it right. And the God of the good times is still God in still God in the night, the God of the day is still God in the night. Yes, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
God, we just invite your presence in this morning. Fall on us, Lord Jesus. Lord, minister to our hearts, God. Just open up your hearts and begin to worship Him. Yes, Jesus.
I feel the wings of your love. Feel the winds of your spirit, and now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. I feel the winds of your love, feel the winds of your spirit, now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. Let it rain. Let it. gates of heaven, let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven.
As we prepare for communion, just begin to open up your heart to receive from him this morning. Lord, you're our daily bread, God. Yes, Jesus. Thank you for the freedom to worship. Come and gather together. You all praise, worship, and glory because you deserve it so much. Yes, Jesus.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy
Your voices to him. Come on, sing it out. Desperate, Jesus.
And I'm desperate for you. Hallelujah. And I'm lost without.
Lift your voices, guys.
And I'm lost without you.
Thank you, Jesus.
And
said, I'm going to prepare you for this disaster. I'm going to give you a way. I will keep you safe. Just think of that day that that dove came in with the olive branch. It's like, it's going to be okay. He protected them that whole way. If you ask, if you listen, he will protect you the whole way.
Thank you.
Amen. Y'all be seated for a moment here as we prepare for communion together. Good to see everybody. The Lord's Supper, our communion, is a remembrance of what Christ did for us. Amen? We got that? It's a celebration of what we receive as a result of this magnificent sacrifice that was done on our behalf. This morning, I want us to stop. I want us to breathe, to pause, and really take a look at our hearts. What's inside of us? Examine who we are in Christ Jesus. Who am I in this body of Christ? This body that I'm sitting in today. We are all a part of the body of Christ. Who am I in this body? And me in this body, am I broken as Christ was broken? Where am I in this? Where's my place? And so let's examine our hearts this morning. First, Corinthians 11, 27 says, therefore, whoever eats the Lord's bread or drinks the Lord's cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of desecrating the body and the blood of the Lord. So let a person examine himself first, and then he may eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For a person who eats and drinks without recognizing the body, and I'll pause here, without recognizing the body. We are the body of Christ without recognizing one another. Eats and drinks judgment unto himself. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, many sleep. I read an excerpt from John Corson I want to share with you this morning before we join in communion with one another. And John wrote, the Lord's table is the very place for the person struggling with sin, wrestling with temptation, or caught up in carnality. For it is there that he can say, Lord, I desperately need you in my life. I eat of your body and I drink of your blood, knowing that I am forgiven. And I thank you, Lord. And I celebrate what you did for me. Because you don't value the Lord's Supper, Paul said, there's people in your midst who are weak, folks who are sick, some who have even died because they haven't understood the potency or the vitality inherent in communion. Too often, communion is nothing more than a meaningless tradition or a ritual. Thus, many remain in a state of spiritual weakness because they don't give worth or value to the place of communion. Ours, John says, is the first generation in history that does not emphasize communion. One cannot read the book of Acts or church history without a very real awareness of the Lord's Supper, that it was central to the life of the congregation. Today, however, some go months, even years, without communion because it's not important to them. And because of this failure to give it worth, people are dying physically, dying emotionally, dying spiritually in ways they need not be, failing to discern the power of the broken body, the cleansing of the shed blood. So I want to take a moment this morning to discern. Just a time of silence, and close your eyes if you need to. But inspect your heart this morning. Discern yourself this morning in a minute of silence. A minute can be a long time to be with yourself, can't it? Now, having done that, I want us to look around the room this morning, because this is the body. Do take a minute to look around and consider your brothers and sisters in the Lord, those whom you join this morning in a common union. Think about them. Evaluate your relationship with them. Evaluate your relationship with them. Am I okay with him? Am I all right with her? Or are we okay? I ask that because that person is the church. And we ought not have aught with the church. So I take a moment right now to tell you that you don't have to sit where you're at. That if you believe that there's an issue between you and another person in this fellowship this morning, this body of believers, remember, they are the church. And we ought not have aught with the church. So if you have an issue this morning or something that needs to be taken care of, I urge you to get up, go to them, and pray with them. And don't nobody think bad. And I'm going to also ask that if there is someone in particular here this morning that you would like to draw close to, and be alongside of and share the body and blood of Christ together with them, that you would also do that. For a moment, think about. Don't fight it. If it's there, you take care of it. You deal with Holy Spirit. Then I'm going to believe two things. That everyone in here is in love with one another. I'm also going to believe you don't love somebody enough to go sit with them. Yeah, God's good. Amen. Amen. I have my ushers up here, please. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. It's a joy. This is a joy, people. It's a joy to celebrate with great remembrance what Christ has done for us. Father, we ask your hands a blessing upon the gifts that we're about to receive, Father. We give you thanks for these gifts. We cherish them and receive them as having been handed them by you. Father, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Go ahead and pass those out, please. Love them enough, you can give them a kiss on the cheek. It's okay. I hope that you at home that are watching us live right now, that you've joined us in considering, submitting, loving, and that we all are joined together as that one body of Christ this morning. So let's take communion with great thankfulness, with great gratitude in our hearts this morning, gratefulness in our hearts. The apostle wrote, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered unto you." And I say that this morning. I received from Paul what I'm about to share with you. That the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He gave thanks for it. And when he had given thanks, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body. It was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Now, as we eat this broken bread, let's remember that we too are to be broken. We too are to be broken for one another. So take and eat and remember. Thank you, Jesus. And in the same manner, he took the cup. He gave thanks to the Father for it. And he took that cup, and he said, "This is the cup of a new covenant, a brand new covenant that I make with you. Drink. And this do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. You proclaim the Lord's victory. You proclaim your cleansing until he comes. And he is coming. So join me in the cup of our salvation. And let's remember. Sing that song. Mm-hmm. Just the chorus.
And I
so lost without you, Lord. Thank you for the gift of salvation, Lord, for dying for us, God, for shedding your blood for us, Lord. Let's sing this.
Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
God's people said hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And thank you, Jesus. Oh, amen. Oh, thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. I want to take a moment just to thank everyone that's been praying for myself, Denny, for our family, in the loss of our mom. Was doing some considering the other day, and I used to think that it was easier to lose someone when you've had time to prepare for it rather than an accident occurring. And I thought, well, I don't know. You know, is it easier to see the headlight of a train coming down the track or easier to have one hit you from behind? And I thought, well, you know what? I need not worry about the train at all. I need to walk in such a way as the train's not there. I'm not concerned about it. I can't die. You can fold this tent up, and this tent's going to fall to the ground one day. But I, because of Jesus Christ and his magnificent sacrifice, ain't never going to die. Amen. Amen. So let it come. I am so grateful to you. You have all been there for us. And we are going to celebrate her funeral next week. She was brought back home to Newman. I was able to go spend a week with my sister. I really didn't know if I was going to be back today, but we kind of planned it. You know, we've gone and visited Georgia quite a bit. I suppose we all have gone to visit family. And it's not a personal one-on-one time. It's like family. I mean, the kids are running around. They're screaming. There's doors slamming. There's put that down and don't go there. And Uncle Joe's over there. Aunt Lou's over there. And Mom's over here. And Sister's over there. And that. You know what I'm talking? I had an opportunity to spend a week with my sister. Just her and just me. And I want to tell you, if you're sitting in this room today, you've got a brother, you've got a sister that you have not done that with, take the time. Because it was absolutely precious. We laughed, we cried, we joked, we had an awesome time together. And I want to thank you for the prayers that took me there. So do that. Do that. If you've got a brother or a sister that you visit, yeah, you go visit. And go here and go there, and we got to go to the museum, and then we got to go over here and see this. And, oh, you know, so-and-so's playing down at, yeah. You, just take that time and spend together and laugh and cry and remember and joke and enjoy the time that's given you. She reminded me of a story, and I'm gonna share it. Did I share with you all about the time I was going to run away? I was going to run away. I had my bicycle, and I was standing in the alleyway with my bike, and my mom was over there, and I was, and my mom looked at me, my pretty little 5'4" mother, looked at me and said, "If you don't get back in this yard, I am going to beat the hell out of you." And that's when I became a Christian. No. And Joanne and I are laughing because she remembered she was there. And so I grabbed my bicycle, I looked up that alley, and I looked back at Mom, and I thought, yeah. So I rolled it back in the yard. And as I passed her right here, I could see out of the corner of my eye, she's coming. And so I threw my bicycle down, and I ran to the house, and I ran in the back door of a really tiny house. And right in front is the cook stove. And so I made a hard left down the hallway, and she kicked my foot. And I face planted. And then she got up on top of me and had a knee on each arm. And she took off a penny loafer. And she whooped me good. That little 5'3", loving, quiet, lovely woman. When I got up off the floor, I was crying, you know, and I said, you said, come to the yard, meet the hell out of you. And my mom looked at me and said, I changed my mind. Lord, I'm so glad you're not going to change your mind. Anyway, I just want to take the opportunity to thank you all and just let you know that we so appreciate your love, your compassion, your prayers. Really, really appreciate it. So I prepared for you a guest speaker today. I know Rick was here last week. And did a good job and wonderful job and today. So, Pastor, would you come up?
Thank you, my dear.
Sick'em girl.
Come on, guys. Wake up.
Oh, yeah. I keep hearing people say, I need a getaway. We got that getaway that takes them to a whole new place. Won't leave us empty. Won't leave us craving more. We be burning for the world to see.
Praise the Lord. Well, I want to say thank you too to last week and came up and had hands laid on me and prayed for me, and the love that has just been poured out has been really such a blessing. I cannot thank you enough. And I had a wonderful week, absolutely wonderful week, and I'm believing that whatever that crazy thing was, it is gone in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. All righty. So I have kind of a serious message this morning, but I am going to quit at 12 o'clock. Okay? So y'all can watch that clock if you want. I got mine right here. Yeah. I'm gonna stop at 12 o'clock, so I might not get done. But we've got youngsters in this morning, and I don't want to wear out anybody. So anyway, let's just open in prayer, shall we? Father, I just give you thanks for the privilege of standing here, Lord God. You have put a word in my heart, and it's just been burning, Lord. And so what a privilege it is that I could stand before these that I love so much and just be able to share what I believe you're speaking to me, and I think to the body of Christ, Lord God. And so, Father, I just pray, as Paul did in Ephesians, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, make us the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened, and that we would know, we would of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead, and he seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. Amen? And so I just pray that, Lord God, that you would, by your Spirit, help me to communicate the things that you have laid on my heart. Thank you, Father. And so I entitled my sermon, God's People. I really did this like a real pastor, you guys. I have a title to my sermon, and I have 3 points I want to make. And I might not get it done, like I said, but we'll get a start on it. And the first point I want to make is division. Division in the world, division in the body of Christ, which is so prevalent right now. And it is a sign of the times. We know that we're in the last days. We don't know what that means as far as the timing, but when Jesus returned to the Father, that began the last days, the latter days. And so we're 2,000 years further into it than we were then. The second point I want to make is, what is it to be God's people or kingdom citizens? And finally, how Jesus dealt with division in his day. And so I want to take you to Luke 21, if you want to turn there, please. And we'll start at verse 6. I'm going to read quite a little bit because I want to put this in context. I thought about just pulling out the key verses that I was wanting to emphasize, but I thought, you know what? When we read the word, we need to read it in context. So let's read a little bit further. So again, Luke 21, and starting at verse 7. I like the Amplified version, and so that's what is up on the screen if it's easier for you to read along that way. And they asked him, "Teacher, when will this happen? And what sign will there be when this is about to occur?" And he said, "Be on your guard and be careful that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name, appropriating to themselves the name Messiah, which belongs to me, saying, 'I am he,' and 'The time is at hand.' Do not go out after them. And when you hear of wars and insurrections, disturbances, disorder, and confusion. Do not become alarmed and panic-stricken and terrified, for all this must take place first, but the end will not come immediately. Then he told them, nation will rise up against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And that word nation in the Greek is ethos, which means ethnicity. It actually means race against race. Is any of this sounding familiar? They dealt with it then, and it's the same spirit that wreaked havoc then that is wreaking havoc now. So he said, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be mighty and violent earthquakes, and in various places, famines and pestilence, plagues, malignant and contagious or infectious epidemic diseases, which are deadly and devastating. And there will be sights of terror and great signs from heaven. But previous to all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, turning you over to the synagogues and prisons, and you will be led away before kings and governors for my sake, for my name's sake. This will be a time, an opportunity for you to bear testimony. I think that is really awesome. And that's exactly what happened to them in that day, is they suffered greatly. They were persecuted. They were put to death. They had to hide, to gather together. But Jesus said, this is going to be a time of testimony. I think this is a time of testimony for us. Resolve and settle it in your minds not to meditate, and prepare beforehand how you are to make your defense and how you will answer. For I myself will give you a mouth and such utterance and wisdom that all of your foes combined will be unable to stand against or refute. You will be delivered up and betrayed even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and some of you they will put to death. And I just hate to say the divisions that are happening amongst many families right now. And you will be hated, despised by everyone because you bear my name and for its sake. But not a hair on your head shall perish. By your steadfastness and patient endurance, you shall win the true life of your souls. Steadfast and patient endurance. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know and understand that its desolation has come near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let those who are inside the city get out of it, and let not those who are out in the country come into it. For those are days of vengeance, of rendering full justice or satisfaction, that all things that are written may be fulfilled. All things that are written are being fulfilled today. Alas, for those who are pregnant and for those who have babies which they are nursing in those days. For great misery and angst and distress shall be upon the land, and indignation and punishment and retribution upon this people. They will fall by the mouth and the edge of the sword, and will be led away as captives to and among all nations. And Jerusalem will be trodden down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled, they're completed. And there will be signs in the sun and moon and stars, and upon the earth there will be distress, trouble, and anguish of nations and bewilderment and perplexity, without resources, left wanting, embarrassed, in doubt, not knowing which way to turn, at the roaring, the echo, the echo of the tossing of the sea. It kind of reminds me of what's going on right now, too. Men swooning away or expiring with fear and dread and apprehension and expectation of the things that are coming on the world, for the very powers of the heavens will be shaken and caused to totter. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with great transcendent and overwhelming power and all his kingly glory, majesty, and splendor. Now, when these things begin to occur, Look up and lift up your heads, because your redemption, your deliverance, is drawing near. I believe that's a word for us today. When these things are happening, look up. And he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they put forth their buds and come out and leaf, you see for yourselves and perceive and know that summer is already near. Even so, when you see these things taking place, understand and know that the kingdom of God is at hand. Truly, I tell you, this generation who's living at the definite period of time will not perish and pass away until all has taken place. The sky and the earth, that is the universe, the world, will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But take heed to yourselves and be on your guard, lest your hearts be overburdened and depressed, weighed down with the giddiness and headache and nausea of self-indulgence, drunkenness, and worldly worries and cares pertaining to the business of this life, unless that day come upon you suddenly like a trap or a noose. For it will come upon all who live upon the face of the entire earth. Keep awake. Keep awake then, and watch at all times. Be discreet, attentive, and ready, praying that you may have the full strength and ability and be accounted worthy to escape all these things taken together that will take place and to stand in the presence of the Son of Man. Pretty sobering word. Pretty sobering word. And we can read that and say, well, that was for then. But the same spirit that was operating then is operating today. And he's got nothing new under the sun. And Jesus gave us his word for instruction to prepare us. And so that's my aim right now in reading these scriptures. Let's read one more and then we'll go on. Matthew 24, and we'll start at verse 10. This also speaks. This was the same time. Now Matthew's reporting, and this is what he had to say. He said, and then many will be offended and repelled and will begin to distrust and desert him whom they ought to trust and obey, and will stumble and fall away and betray one another and pursue one another with hatred. And many false prophets will rise up and deceive and lead many into error. And the love of the great body of people will grow cold because of multiplied lawlessness and iniquity, but he who endures to the end will be saved. And this good news of the kingdom, the gospel, will be preached throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. And then the end will come. So if we want Jesus to come back, we need to be busy preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Amen? So I've been observing the spirit of division in the world and in the church, and this really has been concerning me. I have to be honest with you, almost all the conversations I'm hearing lately, in or outside of the church, are about the COVID pandemic and the statistics concerning it, the issue of Black Lives Matter, politics in the upcoming election. Those are the main conversations that I'm hearing right now. Even amongst Christians, there's disagreement when these subjects come up, and I've even seen and witnessed some pretty heated discussions. I see God's people offending and being offended, some even leaving the church. Y'all might not be aware of that, but there's some missing, and that's why. Not everybody believes the same things that we believe. We might think they do, but some have been very offended. So what's going on? What do you think? What is the truth? Who can we believe? Many people don't know what to believe. I'm one of them. I hear so much stuff. there's a spirit of confusion in the air, and we kind of read about that in I can't remember if it was in Luke and Matthew, but they were confused. They were running fro. They didn't know what to do. People are confused. The facts don't bring clarity. There's so much information out there from different sources with different agendas that it's getting harder and harder to trust what you hear. Who's telling the truth? I keep saying if I could find a source that I can depend on to tell the truth, just tell the facts. You don't have to give me your opinions. You don't have to color it. Just tell, give me the facts. If I could find something like that, I'd be on board on staying up to date on that kind of stuff. And I do think that we need to not hide our heads in the sand. I believe that we do need to be informed. But unfortunately, the sources that can truly inform us with the right, truthful information, they're just few and far between. And I don't have time for that. I just don't have time for that. And so, honestly, I've spoken to many of you already that I associate a lot with. I tell you, I don't watch the news. I'm not on social media. I don't read the paper. I'm not on the internet because I don't have time for that. I really just don't have time for that. My husband stays informed, and he tells me what little I want to know. But honestly, I believe with all my heart that God will let me know what's going on. I really believe that. And so I believe that there's a great distraction going on. I believe that so much of this is intended to distract the people of God. Because I see it. I see the distraction. And I really believe that the devil is using this craziness to distract God's people. He knows his time is short and he is working overtime, let me tell you. And I know y'all are feeling it. I told my teens, I said, I have a different point of reference than you do because I've been here for 66 years. These teens are like 14, 15, 16. And so I told them, I said, all this stuff going on may seem like, yeah, it's weird, but, you know, probably, you know, I mean, I said, no, it's really weird. It's really weird. I have never in 66 years seen it like this. I've seen some stuff. I grew up in the 60s, people. But this is like, woo. I mean, it just seems to be coming from every angle. It's incredible. And unfortunately, some people, they've got their TVs on all day long listening to the news. Some are spending great amounts of time on the internet searching for facts. Some still get their news from newspapers, believe it or not. Yeah. Some are listening to their friends or other experts on social media. He said, she said, did you hear this? You know, it's like, oh, gosh, give it a break. Though I believe that these are very serious issues, I'm not undermining that. I also see how Satan is using it to divide. So, my question to you all at the sound of my voice, what are you feeding on? What's your mind occupied with? How much time are we spending in the book, this one? This one right here. I know I can trust this. How much time are we spending in that? How much time are we spending quietly before the Lord, enjoying him and bringing him our prayers and petitions? He promised that he would hear us. So, why are we spending so much time on all this other stuff? What's it produce? Anxiety? Fear? How much time are we spending? I'm sorry, I don't get along with these things. How much time are we spending listening for truth and guidance? He said, nothing will happen on this earth that you won't be told ahead of time. But we got to be listening. And if our minds are preoccupied with all the other stuff, I'm sorry, but you aren't going to hear it. Most of you have heard me say, at least give God equal time. At least do that. If you're going to spend an hour watching news on TV, internet, whatever, talking about all the stuff that's going on, give God equal time. Spend an hour with Him. Let's talk about Him. Okay? What's the great things God's been doing for you lately? Let's have those conversations. Golly, it's 12 o'clock. Oh, my goodness. Next week, at this same place, at this same time, we're going to talk about what is it to be God's people, kingdom citizens. What does that mean? What's that look like? All right? So I didn't want to leave you on a bummer. It's really not a bummer at all. I just really believe that God is saying, wake up, my people. Wake up, my people, because you can make a difference. But as long as the enemy is distracting you with things that are not true, which I venture to say that a great majority of it is not true. I can't give you a percentage, but it's proven itself out that it's not true. Many of the things that we're hearing and seeing, the news media, they tilt it. They only show you certain things. The statistics that come out, it just depends on whose agenda, what they're trying to prove. And so God is saying, wake up, my people. Wake up. I really can prepare you, and you can walk in peace and victory. All right? So, Father, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for the body of Christ. I want to thank you for people who hunger and thirst after you, Lord God. I want to thank you for people who go out in a world that is looking for answers and has the answer, Lord. I want to thank you for that. I want to thank you, Lord God, that this is a great time to live. I want to thank you, Father, that this is a time for testimony. And people may not understand it. They may think you don't care because you can walk in peace. But Lord God, I thank you that you will be revealed through your people. And let us be those. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for spending time with us this morning. Thank you for being online with us this morning. God bless you, everyone. Give somebody some sugar before you get out of here. Amen.